Good morning to you all. To everyone, those here in the sanctuary this morning, on Zoom and on YouTube. My name is Norm Hrofker, and I'm the proud minister of this congregation, the Universalist Unitarian Church of Halifax, established here in 1837. Jessica Friesen is our music director. Marie-Claude LaRue is our director of religious exploration. John Piccolo is our volunteer director and technician. And this morning, Vitska Gradstein is our special service assistant. During the service today, the chat function will be open, and I invite you all to extend hospitality to anyone that you may want to say hello to. Please welcome any new faces that you see. If you're new or returning from a long absence, you may want to leave contact information in the chat section. Or if you're not already receiving notifications from our church and you'd like to receive updates then on our activities and our services, then please send an email to me, minister@uuch.ca. Before I proceed, I have a few announcements. The order of service was sent out late yesterday, and it contains more detail on the following announcements. We still have a Thursday night chat group on Zoom that you're welcome to join. It's kind of an informal group for people who are looking for a little bit of connection in this time of social isolation. The details for the connection are in the order of service that was sent out yesterday. We have resumed services in the sanctuary in a hybrid way, so we have people in the sanctuary and we have people online as well. And you're encouraged to come to the service if you would like to, but the procedure right now is to get in touch with Margaret Galbraith ahead of time, if possible, to let her know that you're coming. We're having kind of a soft start, so there's not too many people in the sanctuary today. Hopefully that'll grow gradually. The plan is to have up to 15 people in the sanctuary, and we have room for another 15 in the ballroom. There is a Truth, Healing, and Reconciliation film discussion series that you were supposed to register for by Friday. And if you have registered, please contact Margaret so that we can, maybe people want to participate together in watching the movies or have our own discussion group. Last Friday was the deadline. I have a suspicion that if you were to call or contact them early on Monday, they might be able to allow you to participate as well. Now, I am very excited about this announcement. And it's going to be the last open call for anyone interested in participating in the UU Wellspring Adult Religious Exploration Program. You've heard me talk about it. It's a 10-month program of distinctly Unitarian Universalist spiritual development that was started in 2005. The program celebrates the depth and the breadth of our rich religious tradition. And we have enough people now to launch the program. If you're interested in joining this program, I need to hear from you by the end of the day on Monday, if at all possible. We have the minimum number now, but we have room for a few more people if you'd like to participate. And so to officially recognize this exciting initiative, we have a special message this morning from Linnea Nelson, who's the director of the program.
Hello, Universalist Unitarian Church of Halifax. My name is Linnea Nelson, and I come to you from UU Wellspring, a program that I think you've been hearing a lot about. UU Wellspring is a year-long program that allows you to develop your own spiritual journey, to deepen your spiritual life, find what's important to you, develop your own purpose in life, and carry it out with the support of your group. UU Wellspring is really taking off in Canada, and we're very much enjoying having you leading the way. Mississauga, as well as Winnipeg, are both starting programs this year. In fact, they've both already started. And we have many other ministers and religious professionals who have taken UU Wellspring in an online program and who plan to bring it to Canadian Unitarian Universalist congregations over the next few years. I do hope that you are considering this commitment of a year of really looking at your own spiritual life, Not only do I hope that you find it to be so rewarding and an experience that will be transformational, but I also hope that as many of you take it from your congregation, you will find that as a congregation, you have rich discussions and you are able to move forward with your whole congregation in a way that allows all of you to draw on one another's experiences and to find ways to be called into this world with the work of love and justice that we as Unitarian Universalists are called to do. So good luck on this wonderful year. I'll be here to guide your minister and you in any way that I can be supportive. And I'm just sure that you, all of you in Halifax, are in for a wonderful year. Blessings to all of you.
Thank you. That's a message from Linnea Nelson, the director of the, UU Wellspring Program. At this time in each Sunday service, we acknowledge that we are on unceded Mi'kmaq territory, the land of the Mi'kmaq, Mi'kma'ki. Sometimes, to be honest, it seems like an uncomfortably hollow formality. But even then, it's important that we do it. When we feel uncomfortable, we should be asking ourselves, what are we doing to act on this acknowledgement? I mentioned the film series coming up, which helps our own understanding and education. And today we'll be devoting the service to the idea of Treaty Day and our role as treaty people. We're here to establish and maintain respectful relations with the Mi'kmaq. I now invite Vitska to read our chalice lighting words.
The beauty of listening is that those who are listened to start feeling accepted, start taking their words more seriously, and discovering their own true selves. Listening is a form of spiritual hospitality by which you invite strangers to become friends, to get to know their inner selves more fully, and even to dare to be silent with you.
Thank you, Vitska. And now, this morning, I invite Colin Kerr to light our chalice here in the sanctuary. It's a bit of an occasion because it's the first time that someone at the service in person has lit the chalice here since March. Thank you, Colin. And now, Jessica will lead us in our opening hymn.
Okay, so we will be singing All Creatures of the Earth and Sky. All the verses should be up there, but we're only going to do 1, 2, and 3. All creatures of the earth and sky, come kindred and lifted high. Alleluia, alleluia, bright burning sun with golden beams, soft shining moon with silver gleams. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. People who are in the congregation, if you want to sing, that would be amazing. Swift rushing wind, so wild and strong, white clouds that sail in heaven long. Alleluia, alleluia, fair rising morn in praise rejoice. High stars of evening find a voice. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Blowing water, pure and clear, make music for all to hear. Alleluia, alleluia, dance flame of fire so strong and bright, and bless us with your warmth and light. Alleluia, alleluia.
So we have a very powerful video for you this morning. We'll begin the service. I'm sure most of you are familiar with the writings of the Mi'kmaq poet, Rita Joe. She was born on March 15, 1932, and died on March 20th of 2007. A Mi'kmaq poet and songwriter, she's often referred to as the poet laureate of the Mi'kmaq people. Perhaps her most famous poem is entitled, I Lost My Talk. When Rita Joe read her poem, it was with a gentle, sad, and resigned voice. This morning, I bring you another younger interpretation by Canadian actor and producer Gabrielle Nabrita Patan.
I lost my talk. The talk you took away when I was a little girl at Chubinacadi School. You snatched it away. I speak like you. I think like you. I create like you. The scrambled ballad about my word. Two ways I talk, both ways I say. Your way is more powerful. So, gently, I offer my hand and ask. Let me find my talk so I can teach you about me.
I'm sure many of you, maybe most of you, are familiar with the writing of the Mi'kmaq poet Rita Joe. She was born on March the 15th, 1932, and died in 2007. She was a Mi'kmaq poet and songwriter, often referred to as the poet laureate of the Mi'kmaq people. Perhaps her most famous poem is the one you just heard, entitled, I Lost My Talk. What you heard is a younger, more recent interpretation of that poem. When Rita Joe read her poem, it was gentle and sad, sometimes with a resigned voice. I'm pleased to bring you that younger interpretation by Canadian actor and producer Gabrielle Nabrita Pepin. So, I have three reflections for you this morning. The first one's the longest one, so don't worry that I'm going to ramble on forever. We begin a new month as a congregation with a new theme, a theme of deep listening. Deep listening is hard for Unitarian Universalists. It's hard for most people. Deep listening requires that we listen with our full attention and that we resist the natural temptation to offer advice, offer solutions, offer fixes, explain things from our perspective. We're encouraged to ask open-ended questions, but not leading questions. We're expected to start from a place where we admit our ignorance and our limitations. When you listen deeply, it's not about you. It's about the person or the persons that you're listening to. The underlying idea is that each individual knows what we need to do. But we need to hear ourselves talk in a safe space with a supportive group around us, not judging, not fixing, but encouraging and making a safe space for us to explore and to find our own way. I wanted to turn that focus of deep listening to the idea of Treaty Day and the relationship between settlers like myself and most of you hearing my voice and the people whose land this was for thousands of years before we came. This morning I want to encourage you to listen to the Indigenous voices of the past, Indigenous voices of the present, and Indigenous voices from the future. And try to see our place today in the broader sweep of history. This raises religious questions, spiritual questions for each of us. What's our role in the injustices that continue to befall the Aboriginal peoples of this great land? I'll digress here for a moment. Many of you know the value that I've placed on serendipity in living a good life. I spent several hours yesterday with 15 or 20 members of the congregation sorting through George Marenfeld's locker full of books and academic papers. More on that in Joys and Sorrows. One book presented itself to me, and I mean that. It was just there on the top of a pile that I was sorting. It's a thin copy titled Mi'kmaq Fisheries, Toward a Better Understanding, and it was published in 1993. It was a great help for me in preparing for today's service. The arrival of Europeans on Turtle Island is not ancient history. The ramifications of the influx of settlers to this land are reverberating loudly around us today. Treaties between the British Crown and the Mi'kmaq were signed between the years 1725 and 1761. That's barely a blink in the history of the peoples of this land. Treaty Day honors the Peace and Friendship Treaty of 1752 in particular. That treaty was honored by the settlers only when it served their purposes. And that wasn't very long at all. But a very surprising thing happened. In 1985, the Supreme Court of Canada affirmed the Treaty of 1752, that it was still strong. And the Supreme Court called upon Her Majesty to honor the treaty and others made with the Mi'kmaq Nation. Those treaties and the 1985 court decision are the basis for the ongoing negotiations over fishing rights, for example, that are in our news today. We are living history today. I don't want to imply that deep listening is the panacea for every problem, but in essence, what happened was our justice courts listened deeply to the Indigenous people of this land and created a safe space for them, empowering them to find their own way forward. When Europeans arrived in North America, they were originally welcomed by Indigenous people. I quote from the book that I mentioned, "We are now known as Mi'kmaq. Nimaq, a salutation meaning my kin, is how we greeted Europeans to our world." Each side of this meeting of cultures could see the benefits for themselves. The land, waters, and sky teemed with wildlife. The Mi'kmaq expected to benefit from the new technologies and trade. That was so short-lived. Listen to Mi'kmaq voices from 1849, less than 100 years later. In 1849, the Mi'kmaq petitioned Nova Scotia's lieutenant governor with these words, "Be not offended at what we say, for we wish to please you. But your people had not land enough. They came and they killed many of our tribe, and they took from us our country. You have taken from us our lands and trees. You have destroyed our game. The moose yards of our fathers, where are they? White men kill the moose and leave the meat in the woods. You have put ships and steamboats upon the waters, and they scare away the fish. You have made dams across the rivers so that the salmon cannot go up. And your laws do not permit us to spear salmon." It's important to know that Mi'kmaq communities were based on the coasts in the summer, along the rivers that teemed with salmon. They feasted on the bounty of the rivers and the sea. The European settlers took everything and they determined to stamp out the culture of the Mi'kmaq. The pictures, I have two pictures here from Central Canada. They're not from the Maritimes, but they illustrate a point. The pictures were carefully posed by professional photographers hired by the Canadian government to win support for the residential school system. The young boy in these pictures, Thomas Moore Kisik, was sent home from school when he developed tuberculosis, and he died shortly afterwards. We listen with more than our ears. Look at these pictures. What's your reaction? They're the same person in two very different contexts. Do these pictures raise questions for you? What's your immediate reaction? Is the boy better off or worse off? What do your responses say about your own racial bias? These questions raise serious questions for me. Now, Marie-Claude has selected a story from the present time.
Good morning. We're about to hear Rebecca Thomas share her illustrated poem, I'm Finding My Talk. This was written as a response to Rita Jo's poem, I Lost My Talk. Rebecca Thomas is a Mi'kmaq activist and poet, and Halifax's former poet laureate. She is a second generation residential school survivor, and she's been rediscovering her talk, her community, her culture, and her language. Let's listen deeply as Rebecca shares her experiences. Here's I'm Finding My Talk.
Nindaloisi Rebecca Thomas, Dalewi Jibuktuk Migamagi. My name is Rebecca Thomas. I'm from Halifax, Nova Scotia, and I am the author of Finding My Talk. So today, I'm going to share my book and my story that I wrote. I'm Finding My Talk is about me finding what it's like to be a Mi'kmaq person in this day and age. I grew up with a dad who went to residential school, who lost his ability to speak Mi'kmaq and his idea and culture, and I had to learn that my own way. So here we go. I'm finding my talk, the one I never had, the one that the schools took away from my dad. I'm finding my talk one word at a time. Gwe, Walalan, Namultes. Sometimes they are very old, and sometimes they rhyme. I'm finding my talk when I'm up on the stage, telling big stories or scribbling words on a page. I'm finding my talk, I'm meeting my family. I'm making new friends who choose to love me. I'm finding my talk with clumsy feet that pat down the grass with every drum beat. I'm finding my talk. With every bead, my regalia speaks through each stitch and seam. I'm finding my talk. It's in my smudge bowl when the smoke curls around me and makes me feel whole. I'm finding my talk, how it's written across the land, learning to take only what I need. Nidugalum helps me understand. I'm finding my talk through my community. From elders to kids, this world is still new to me. I'm finding my talk by speaking to my father, by loving him and being his daughter. I'm finding my talk by speaking with my sister, knowing we're different, and I miss her. I'm finding my talk through my nephews and nieces, teaching them they are complete with all their different pieces. I'm finding my talk. It's on the inside. It's how I see the world through not one, but two eyes. I'm finding my talk, and it may take some time, but I'm learning to speak in a language that's mine. Walalia, thank you so much for reading with me.
We take this special time now to reflect on our joys and sorrows. It's a sacred time in the service, a time that we set apart to honor the many joys and the many sorrows that you, the congregation, are living, and to acknowledge the mutual support of our community. Today I light one candle for all those who are here with us or in our thoughts, or are struggling mentally, physically, financially, or emotionally. And I'll light a second candle for all the joys that are in the room, the big joys that come along infrequently, and the little joys that we are blessed with every day if we have eyes to see. Each week, I invite anyone with a joy or a sorrow to share at this time to relay their thoughts to me by email. And now that we have people in the sanctuary, we can invite people in person to light candles as well. I'd like to light a candle again for the members and friends of our congregation that remain shut in long-term care homes. Things are gradually improving. People are being able to get out with family if they have family that are able to take them out. This morning, a candle for John Patterson, Marie Davis, Irisha Cox, Ann Wood, Norm Sabowitz, and Dr. Philip Welch. Yesterday, we had a very special event, and Vitska would like to say some words, and I'll light a candle to commemorate what happened.
Yeah, yesterday, during the clearing out of George's locker, which is in a storage facility and where he used to go in the times he was still alive to be with his books, during that time, I couldn't help but turn to former church member Kathy Spencer and ask her how it was all those years ago when they put all those books there. She happened to be the chair of the caring committee at the time. She said, I couldn't have done it without the help of all those, that very strong group of people in the UU Church. That group, I remember very well. I was not there when those books were moved there because I was having MS and had difficulties with that. But that group must have included people like Scott Donovan, Laszlo Santer, Tom Smith, probably Dean White too, Helen McFadden, of course, and of course, not to forget, Alan Clark. And there were many others. Yesterday I watched and I saw that besides Kathy Spencer and Mary Lou McDonald, old members of the church, there was a great group of new church members. And they were working their way through those books, and hard work it was. Okay, so it occurred to me that on Tuesday we went to a funeral home to have George's body cremated, his physical remains. But yesterday, our church obliterated the physical remains of his spirit. It was sad, but it was a very good closure. Thank you.
Thank you, Vitska. I want to make a couple of comments, but first I'm going to try and share a very brief video with you to give a quick idea of what it was like yesterday. We had more than 18 people show up, which was amazing. And we needed every one of them. Sure. When there's work to be done, if the work is done in the spirit of love, it is not a chore. It's an opportunity to give our lives meaning and through community. And I thank everyone who came out yesterday, and especially those who stayed to the end when I had to leave to start working on this service. So a candle for all those who helped yesterday, and we've received wonderful multiple emails from George's sister in Belgium, thanking us for doing this work. And we found what we were looking for in the midst of that huge locker. There was a document which was George's master's thesis from the 1960s, written in Europe, in Belgium, and French. And somewhere in that locker, we found it. And now I'd like to light a candle for Faith Piccolo's sister, Peggy Walsh. Faith is in St. John's, Newfoundland today, to be with her sister, Peggy, who's in hospital and undergoing tests. And today, on behalf of the congregation, I want to light one candle for Donald Trump, wishing him a full recovery from the COVID-19 virus. Later, when we stop the live streaming on YouTube and before the coffee hour begins, we'll invite anyone to share a joy or a sorrow if they would like to do so. Now, Jessica will lead us in the reflective hymn.
So today we're going to do something different, as it is Treaty Day. I will be introducing a traditional Muscogee Creek Indigenous song. So after me, I want you to try to say it. Say it along with me. So it is Hele Loyan. So He Le Lo Yan. And that means Alleluia.
Joys and sorrows, both those acknowledged here this morning and those held in the silent sanctuary of our hearts, weave us together in the interdependent fabric of community. Reflection part two, listening to voices from the present. Listen to the voices of the present. We're living in a time pregnant with possibility for a change in the relationship between settlers and the Mi'kmaq. Rebecca Thomas is one example among many of young Mi'kmaq people discovering a newfound pride in their culture and their history. We need to listen deeply. We need to support without trying to take control. My reflections today are not intended to be a lecture on the legal state of negotiations with the Mi'kmaq. They're intended to encourage the members and friends of this congregation to respect the history of the Mi'kmaq, to listen deeply and sympathetically to their cause. The roots of the change that we're living through go back to the Constitution Act of 1982. Again, from my perspective, very recent history. That change amended the Constitution of Canada by adding Section 35(1), which for the first time recognized and affirmed existing Aboriginal and treaty rights as constitutionally protected rights. Then, a few years later, in 1985, the Supreme Court case James Matthew Simon versus the Queen affirmed that the treaties from the 18th century were still valid. The case gave credence to the long-standing belief that the Mi'kmaq survive as a nation, and the relationship between the Mi'kmaq and the Canadian government must be on the basis of nation to nation. One of the things that make this so difficult now is that we've imposed our own governmental systems on the Mi'kmaq people. We didn't listen deeply. We jumped in assuming we knew how they should be organized, how they should do things our way. Reserves and reserve bands and elected councils compete today with systems of hereditary chiefs. As we look for ways to build relationships, we find that we're often building relationships with organizations that are not based on Native culture. Our congregation has reached out and benefited from a relationship with the Mi'kmaq Native Friendship Center here in Halifax. But when I talk to the people at the Mi'kmaq Native Friendship Center, they acknowledge that their organization, as good as it is a product and a tool of the Canadian government. Our Treaty Day, on Treaty Day, the first day of October in 2008, chiefs and councils of 13 Mi'kmaq communities in Nova Scotia came together from across the province to the seat of the Nova Scotia Legislature in Halifax. And I quote here from their proclamation. They came to proclaim and assert the nationhood of the Mi'kmaq in Nova Scotia, their nationhood over their traditional lands and waters. Through this proclamation, the Mi'kmaq chiefs and councils of Nova Scotia agreed to work together to develop a Mi'kmaq governance structure that unites and empowers our nation to enhance the quality of life and the well-being of our people. In preparing for this service, I learned about another organization, the Mi'kmaq Rights Initiative, which is an outgrowth of the initiative by the chiefs and councils that I referred to. This from their website. The Mi'kmaq Rights Initiative is a group that represents the negotiations on behalf of the Mi'kmaq of Nova Scotia with the province of Nova Scotia and the government of Canada. The initiative was developed by the Mi'kmaq for the Mi'kmaq. Through these negotiations, we hope to finally implement our rights from the treaties signed by our ancestors in the 1700s. I reached out to the Mi'kmaq Rights Initiative and received an enthusiastic response. However, I was calling in the middle of a crisis related to the lobster fishery that we're all aware of, and their time was completely consumed with that issue at the time I called. But I look forward to establishing a relationship with the Mi'kmaq Rights Initiative as another connection to the Indigenous community, another way of building relationship. I hope that congregation sees this as important spiritual work, consistent with the principles of Unitarian Universalism. We need to breathe new life into the commitment that we've made to truth and reconciliation. Let's do it together. And now another selection representing the Mi'kmaq of the present Emma Stevens, a 16-year-old from Eskazoni, gained international fame with this recording of Blackbird, sung in Mi'kmaq.
Police get Chwabinito Gnama Seat Lai Jadim Delpidowsin Eskamadamus and Egnigam in Jossin. Police get Chwabinito Ola bin again a mid again Delbert Dowson Eskimodomos and Negnege Seyasin Boodleski Lijasi Don was the day born it by do. Dowsin Eskimodomos and Egnigam in Jossin Eskimodomos and Egnigam in Jossin Eskimodomos and Egnigam in Jossin.
And now, Fiske has a reading for us, titled Listening with the Heart, written by the Reverend Gary Kowalski.
Maybe prayer doesn't mean talking to God at all. Maybe it just means listening. Unplugging the TV, tuning off the computer, turning off the computer, quieting the mental chatter and distractions. Maybe it means listening to the birds, to the insects, to the wind in the leaves, to the creaking and groaning of the trees. Noticing who else is out there, not far away, but nearby. Sitting so still, we can hear our heartbeat, watch our breath, that gentle swoosh of air, the funny noises from your insides. Marveling at the body, we take so much for granted. Maybe it means listening to our dreams, paying more attention to what we really want from life, and less attention to all the nagging, scolding voices from our past. Or maybe it's about listening to each other, not thinking ahead to how we can answer or rebut or parry or advise or admonish, but actually being present to each other. Perhaps if we just sit quietly, you'll overhear a peace whispering through the centuries that's missing from the clamor of the moment. Maybe prayer means listening to the silences between words, noticing the negativity of space, the vast undifferentiated and nameless wonder that underlies it all. Maybe prayer doesn't mean talking to God at all, but listening with the heart to the angel choirs all around us. Those who have ears, let them hear.
Thank you, Vitska. Reflection part three, listening to voices from the future. What if we could listen to the voices from the future? This is one way to see the Aboriginal admonition to plan for seven generations into the future. How will people in Nova Scotia, settlers in Mi'kmaq, judge what we are doing here today? If they could say they listened deeply to one another when speaking about us, if they could say those people listened deeply to one another, they built relationships of trust, they developed a positive vision for the future, then we will have done our job. What do you think the voices from the future are saying to us today? Can you listen that deeply? I leave you with that thought as we move on to our offering. This is a time in the service when, in pre-COVID times, we would pass a collection plate. Instead, today we have this message from the board of the church. The UUCH community has been so loving and generous during this strange and unsettled year. Many thanks to all those who have kept our financial house in good order. Your giving is so much appreciated. We have continued to pay staff. We have offered Saturday brunch bagged lunch, and we stocked the food bank on your generosity. Going forward, we know that we can continue to count on you, and we'd like to. And if you would like to make a donation at this time, you can do so by e-transfer to treasurer@uuch.ca. If you prefer to do this by check, send that check to the church address. This message with gratitude from your board of directors. And now Jessica will lead us in our closing hymn.
Let us build a new way. We are building a new way. We are building a new way. We are building a new way.
Jessica. As we extinguish the flame marking the end of our service, the voices of the past and the future echo in our ears. I invite Vitska to read the chalice extinguishing words.
I have changed them a little bit. I hope you don't mind. As we extinguish this flame, marking the end of our service, the voices of the past, the present, and the future echo in our ears, reminding us of the gifts of the Mi'kmaq people. We hope that we, descendants of people from a great many places in the world, may stand with them to keep the flame of their nation alive in our whirlwind time together.
Thank you, Vitska. I have extinguished the chalice here in the sanctuary, grateful for the fact that we can be here once again and have people in the sanctuary for the service. Thank you all who attended the service today by Zoom or by YouTube or in person. I'll say goodbye now to those who joined by YouTube as we end our live streaming. If you joined by Zoom, please stay on the line. Please help us keep the flame of a relationship with the Mi'kmaq people alive. And remember, if you want to join the UU Wellspring program, I need to hear from you by tomorrow.